Okay, thanks a lot. So first of all, thanks to
my many co-authors in this work, Uri Feige, Aviad Rubinstein, Rob Shapira, Moshe Tenhotz, and Shai Vardi. It's a composition of a few papers that I'm going to talk about today. I guess my main thing is to try to convince you that the question that we are asking is interesting and worthwhile, and maybe sort of convince you even to think about it by yourself. So today, given the short time that I'll have, I'll talk very briefly about robust probabilistic inference. What do we mean by robustness? And try to give a few motivating examples to set the work. I'll discuss sort of the model, which I think is the most interesting thing, and our main result. And hopefully I will have enough time sort of to give you a sample of what the results are like and why I'm so excited about them. Okay, so let's start with what do we mean by robustness? So robust probabilistic inference, probably we should read it like in Hebrew, from right to left. This way we can understand it. Inference is sort of what I assume most of you know. Inference is a mapping from observation to an event. Okay, what do we mean by probabilistic? Probabilistic, we mean that there is an underlying stochastic distribution. There's an underlying distribution that controls the event, and we would like sort of to predict the probability of an event. As a basic example, think about a Bayesian network. So in a Bayesian network, you're observing some of the nodes. Those are your observations. And given the observation, you would like to predict the outcome. Okay, so those two things are classic. I'm not sure now how back do they go, but definitely to the 50s, if not before. What do we would like to discuss? So I'd like to discuss today a new feature, robustness. So what is robustness about? Robustness is the possibility of corrupting the inputs. So usually when we talk about inference, we're thinking that we are seeing an observation that is depending, let's say, on the state of the world. In robustness, we're taking into account that maybe what we are saying is not the truth. And let me start with two motivating examples. The first one is spam detection. So in spam detection, when you build a spam detector, you're trying to detect many small filters, right? You can look at who sent the email. You can see how many times Viagra appears in it. You can look on how many exclamation marks are in it. And what you really have when you're doing a spam filter, you're trying sort of to detect small anomalies. And based on those small anomalies, you would like to say that this is a spam email. But spam filtering is like a game, because there are two sides to the game. The good guys are detecting the spams, but they would be out of business if not for the bad guys, which are sending those spam filters. And no matter how good of a spam filter you can build, if you let it sit around for long enough, and long enough is not ages, but it could be like a year, everyone would be able to work around it. So it's really a game between spammer and detectors, and the spammer really continuously adjusts the context to the detectors, right? So they would sort of change the spelling of a word slightly, people will understand it, filters do not. They would like to learn to fool detectors. In the short range, they would be able to fool a few detectors. In the long range, they would probably sort of be able to fool many. So when we talk about robustness, this is a great example. So what we would like to be able to classify his email correctly, even if the spammers adversarially can corrupt a few detectors. Even if they can get a few detectors to report incorrectly, still we would like the overall results to be correct. And probably any system which is built and has a good performance needs this. Here's a second motivating example. I took like a communication network failure, but you can take it in many other contexts. So in a communication network, sort of, all the times links are failing, all the times routers are down. If you look on a large enterprise, there isn't such a state in which everything is operating. And the question is sort of, what happens when things fail? So in order to detect failures, what usually happens is that we have extra hardware. We put hardware in the network to detect the failure. So we would like sort of to see whether on a certain link, the link is operational, whether there's a high error bit. What we do is we put an extra hardware that detects it. But what happens when the detectors fails, right? So now it's a game, you're putting more hardware, the hardware may fail. Okay, so you would like to model those failures. So you can model those failures using a Bayesian method. And you can model them using a worst case method. So as you can probably guess, I'm going to advocate the worst case and not the Bayesian. But why do I believe that really this is an example where a worst case method would work better than a Bayesian? In a Bayesian modeling, you need to say what happens when things fail. How the hell do you know what happens when things fail? You rarely see them fail, and you need sort of to put, okay, so let's take that you have a device that is trying to put, to see how, what is the error rate on a link, right? So it's very easy to say that the error rate is 100%, right? The link is not operational. But what happens if it reports a 2% error rate? Is this reasonable? Is it not? What's the probability that it will give you a number which looks reasonable but is incorrect? A Bayesian would need sort of to hypothesize all this. A worst case is slightly easier because you're saying, okay, it's a failure. In a failure, I'm not committing to how things fail. Okay, so what we would like? We would like, again, we'd like to get a good performance when failure. And in, like in a network setting, you can think we'd like to overcome, let's say, a single point of failure. Right. So when you talk about a single point of failure, it's like saying it's a worst case setting. Now we can start discussing our model. So there is a single state of the world. Let's just say spam, not spam. And given this state of the world, there is a certain set of observation. Those are the X's. Those are the things that you would have liked to observe. The different, okay, inference usually takes the X's and predicts the Y. This is classical inference. What we added here in the middle is like an adversary. The adversary has the ability to corrupt part of the inputs, and this is the output that you're going to observe. So how can he corrupt the inputs? So here is sort of one major assumption that we make. We assume that he has a set of modification rules, and he's going to use one of them to corrupt the inputs. So basically, he's going to take the input that he observes. You probably cannot see any red dot, right? Okay, he takes the axis, the real state of the world, and then he can generate a new observable. His main limitation is that this set is not going to be large. Think of like a typical example that I would like to think about. Think that he has the ability to flip a single bit. Right. So in the spam detector, he can take one filter and sort of flip its prediction.
Sorry, I can understand the notation here.
Yes.
Row YX means that the devil has access to Y as well?
Yes. Right. Yeah, worst case.
Okay, and it needs to use the same rule to the components of the X vector?
No. So,
X is the vector.
Just a second. So, so let's say row I of yx takes xi, flips it to minus xi, and keeps all the other x's the same, right? So this is just a function that given x and y generates a z. Following up on your question, the question is, when does the adversary operate? So here it operates sort of before x was generated. Like in the spam example, he's building the filter before sort of the clean messages arrives. And there is another model, which is an adaptive model, in which he gets to observe the X, and based on the X that he observes, then he sort of sets up, he selects a modification. So it's a question whether he selects the corruption before X was generated or after X was generated. Okay. Questions. That's very good.
Very intelligent question. But so, row I flips x I, but it observes all of the x.
Yes. Right. Right. This is. I just wanted a simple example. Right. Okay. Let me sort of go over the model more carefully, without sort of picture. Right. We have a state of a world. It's just Boolean for simplicity. We have a set of signals. Just think of it as 0, 1 to the n, let's say n-bit vectors. And then we have sort of a distribution which is known, a known a known prior. And what we'll really assume is that we can sort of both sample it and compute probabilities with respect to it. Okay? So up to here is the classical inference problem, right? What we will have is observed signals. The observed signals are going to be different than the original uncorrupted signals. And we get the observed signal by applying a modification rule. It can take also the state of the world and X and generate Z. Sort of because we are talking later about efficiency, we would like to compute it in polynomial time. And it's going to be a bounded number of modification rules. Here is sort of the example that I already alluded to. But you can have more complex examples. And what is our goal now? Our goal is, given the observed signal, predict the state of the world. This is exactly in the inference setting. Given what you observed, predict spam or not spam. Yes?
So in what sense is this different than in channel coding, where you, based on graphical models, where you also have, either you have an adversarial model or you have like a probabilistic model?
So the difference is sort of here, like the set of modification rules is going to be a set that you can, okay, so like you can select like a modification rule also based on the X.
That's what happens. I mean, then you generate the code word and you corrupt it. And that's what you see at the channel output.
Let's take it offline. I'm not,
Okay.
Okay, so the model, the predictor is given an observed signal, you want to predict a Y, and basically you're going to define a probabilistic policy. The adversary picks a modification rule, it could be static before X is selected or after X is selected. So really we have a zero-sum game. It's a zero-sum game between the predictor and the adversary. Right? So the error given a policy is just the probability of an error. And what we would like is to sort of compute or find a policy that sort of implements the minimax error. So the optimal error is the best error that you can achieve as a predictor, given that the adversary is going to select the modification rules. Right? And what we'll have, we are not going to find the optimal policy, but we are going to find an epsilon optimal policy, a policy which is near optimal. So what's our main results? So the main result is that given an observed signals, we can compute a prediction for Y. We'll have the near optimal error rate, and we can do it both in the static and in the adaptive model. In the static model, we can also handle like a large class of modification rules. In the adaptive, this is what I'm going to do, sort of sketch next. We are going to handle all a rather limited, constant number of modification rules. What am I assuming here in some sense, right? So this all sounds too good to be true. What I'm assuming here is sort of the ability of given an X to know what is the Y. Let's think it's sort of a deterministic relation between the state of the world and the axis. So what I will need is I will need sort of already a solution to the inference problem in the sense that given an X, I have an oracle that I can query and observe the Y. We can also do learning in more classical learning setting. We can think of a finite hypothesis class. We can sort of do the training on clean data and then project to testing on corrupted data. So in this case, what we can show is that given a sample, we can find a near optimal policy in the class. Again, I need to assume something. So I really assume that I'm given empirical risk minimization oracle that given a clean sample can do a minimization. The question, what do I want to minimize? Because I'm later not going to be tested on the same thing, but I'm going to be tested on a corrupted set of data. So we can, given a sample, we can sort of find the best H for this set and then do a generalization bound that guarantees us that if we take a large enough sample, we are near optimal. Okay. this is great. We have only positive results on this slide. Yes.
And the number of possible rules.
M. Do I have M on the slide? Yeah. Right. Yes. Yes.
So, quick question.
Okay.
So, in your formulation earlier, you had the devil has constrained to have a class of M rules. Is that right?
Yes.
So these results don't depend on what the structure of that class of M rules are?
Yes.
They don't?
Yes. They, yeah. Yes, they don't.
Yes, they don't.
Yes. Okay. So, okay. So before I sort of, I'll give you an example. Let's see where does it make a difference. So why would we give a different prediction when we want to be robust? It makes sense that we shouldn't do the same thing because otherwise, probably I wasted your time. Okay, let's think of a simple example. Learning hyperplanes, nice and easy. If you want to minimize the error, you want to minimize the probability, this probability. If you want to do a large margin, then this shouldn't have been zero. This should have been gamma. Right. If you want it sort of to it being a certain margin, you would want it to minimize the error with respect to this margin. Now think what would happen if the adversary can just flip, not flip, can take one of the inputs and zero it out. Okay. So let's assume for simplicity uniform distribution. But really the motivation is very simple now. Now if the adversary can take one input and zero it out, right, what would you like to minimize over, right? So you would like to have those margins large, right? Because if the margin is less than the maximum weight, he can sort of take it and zero it out. In the static case, he's not sure whether he's gaining or not because he doesn't know whether Xi is probability half of doing the half right way or not. In the dynamic case, he will observe the X and Y, and what he would like is sort of he would zero out an attribute which is predicting in the right direction. Okay. I went fairly fast on the slide, but the point was this is similar to this, but there is something very nice here. There is like an adaptive set of margins, right? So you would like, okay, what do we expect to happen at the end? At the end, we expect that because we want to be robust, we cannot put too much weight on let's say, a single attribute. How do we get it? We would get it through this theorem, but sort of having like an adaptive margin. Okay. So now, let me sort of try to sketch, let's say, one part. And I think through this sketch, I'll mainly try to highlight what I find very interesting in this analysis. Probably surprising. So let's start with like a definition. A natural thing is to talk about the corruption graph. So a corruption graph says that this X can be mapped to one of those three Zs. Right? And there is no assumption here about the graph. So you have a graph going from X to Zs. Now, really, we need to weigh those different x's according to those distribution. Fine. On the other side, we can define an interference graph. So an interference graph says that this x has to have to be labeled 0, those x's have to be labeled 1, and we put an edge between them if they can both be mapped to the same observable. So we'll talk for a second about this interference graph. And again, we'll have weights on the nodes, not that important at this point. So for the rest of the talk, assume it's a uniform distribution, it will make the combinatorics much nicer. So here are the optimal policies. So the optimal policy for the adversary is going to be a maximum matching of the graph, and the optimal policy of a predictor would be a minimum vertex set. So a maximum matching does make sense in some sense because if I can pair those things up, for each one of those pairs, I can force one error, right? Regardless of how the predictor will predict. So I can force a number of errors which is equal to the size of the matching. why is this optimal? It's going to be optimal because I can show that really the vertex cover does give you a lower bound, is giving the predictor optimal policy. I'm going to skip over this because I still, like in the 2-3 minutes that I have, I want to jump ahead. So given those optimal policy, we can show it's deterministic. We can compute it in polynomial time, but polynomial in what? Polynomial in the size of the domain. And we want to be polynomial in the dimension. So really, in order to be polynomial in the dimension, we need to use what we call local algorithms. It's not our invention. But here's what are local algorithms. So local algorithm is sort of, has the following flavor. You are given a problem, say a matching in a graph. You are given a set of queries, let's say, given an edge, tell me whether the edge is in the matching or not. Now, given the problem and the queries, you'd like to reply to the queries. You'd like to do it in sublinear times, usually logarithmic time. And you'd like to have like no pre-computation or storage. You might have a slight storage just to have a seed of a random, pseudo-random function. Given all your replies, you would like your solution to be globally feasible. So in this example, it would like it to define a matching and guarantee something about the matching, because you can always say none of the edges are in the matching. You'd like to be near optimal. So this is what a local algorithm would have. And sort of you can get, for example, for matching a local algorithm, the local algorithm would run in polylogarithmic time, it will need some randomness. So this is sort of an efficient algorithm for the bad guys. But we would like to get a predictor policy. So really we need to go from matching to vertex cover. So we'd like to map a maximum matching to a minimum vertex cover, classical and very well known. The problem is that we're never going to have a maximum matching. We're going to have an approximate maximum matching. So the classical sort of transformation does not work here. We want to go from approximate maximum matching to an approximate minimum vertex cover. And for this, what we would need, we will need to use randomization, and I'm not going to get into it. And I think just on time, I'm going to conclude. Just give me 1 minute. Okay, so what did I try to convince you? I think I mainly tried to convince you that robustness is an interesting issue. Maybe you didn't realize it, but now, believe me, this is what I did try. I talked about a static and an adaptive adversary. The main emphasis of this line of work is really about efficient algorithms. In my view, sort of, what I sort of at the end of it described, I think it's an interesting and sort of surprising connection to graph properties. And given this setting, somehow local algorithms, even without any definition by themselves, look very natural. They look like, at first, it's a surprising application, but then when you think about it, it's the right setting. When you are doing an inference, when you are doing a learning problem, you don't want to go over the entire domain. And this is why you do need the ability to sample here and there in order to look at the solution. We do have a few things about learning, and I think sort of the entire, not only the learning part, does need some more work in order to get a better understanding. And with this, let me end.